ranking the top 10 Texans players of all time. Let's talk about it. Go. Oh yeah, hell yeah. Oh my,
this is gonna be fun.
This is gonna be a fun one, bro.
This
is gonna
be fun.
This is a good one. This is one of the topics we talked about when we first talked about doing a podcast,
right?
You know, a Texans podcast in particular, man. It's all H-Town, all Texans all the time.
Yes, so sir.
This is a good one, man. Ranking the top 10 Texans players of all, this is what old niggas do. This is
just to sit around and reminisce.
This is why we exist at this point.
That's hilarious, man. Yeah.
Just bring up old obscure names of Texas players, man.
Oh man, that's good stuff. But that's what we do here, man. Bull Run Sports. Thank you guys for joining us on another episode. This is gonna be fun.
Absolutely.
I'm looking forward to it, man. Because I find it very odd because I already think I kind of have an obscure like view on just football in general. Because for as much as people like, you know, obviously we like scoring, right?
Football.
Yeah, football. Yeah, like for as much as people like all the high flying offense and the receivers and the running backs and the quarterbacks and all that stuff, I'm a defense guy. Okay. I like my defensive players. I like the guys that are out there wreaking havoc. I like the guys that are out there making the stops, getting the plays, denying people their scoring.
You've got to have it.
But see, I prefer that side of the ball, like the defensive side. I mean, even a little bit of football that I did play, I was linebacker. I was the defensive guy. I was always trying to stop the other side from scoring. So for me, it was always fun.
You a cock block.
I'm a ball blocker.
Natural born.
I'm a natural born ball blocker. You know what I mean? So it's man. I've always just liked that side of the ball. So for me, a lot of my players today are gonna come from. There's a few guys that I really like on the offensive side throughout the history of the Texans.
Oh, for sure.
Big defensive guys. So it should be fun,
man. So let's talk. So basically, how we gonna do this? Guys, you know, you're out here watching, like Omar said, you tuned in with us right now, Bull Run Sports, man. We are the most entertaining Texans podcast you're going to find on the interwebs. There's a lot of podcasts out there. There's a lot of Texans content out there on the web right now.
Not as entertaining.
Not as entertaining. A lot of good info, not as entertaining, man. So right now, how we going to do this? How we going to break this down? Like we talked about, we're going to rank our top 10 guys. But we're going to give y'all both of our rankings, you know, because I want to know Omar's full top 10. Y'all gonna get Tricky's full top 10, you know,
right?
So we're gonna bounce back and forth, and we're gonna give it to y'all, and we're gonna go through the guys. So Omar, man, if you're ready,
I'm ready.
If you want to get into it, man, no further ado, give me your number 10, dog.
I give you my number 10, and the reason why he's my number 10 is because. And there's like, as I started putting my list together, I started to realize that I have like a bit of a, like that there's an overarching theme here. And if you can kind of catch on to it, you will. It's pretty interesting. My number 10 is Ed Reed. I love Ed Reed.
All right, guys. It's been cool. Thank you all for joining us here on Bull Run Sports.
Hold on. No. Hear me out. My man just gonna get up and walk away.
Oh,
I told
man.
You, man. I have oddball players that I really, really liked. Like oddball players that I really, really liked.
I can't. You pranking me right now? This is a
no,
this
no,
a
no.
Prank.
I'm telling you, Ed Reed Aston was Kutcher one of my favorite Texans when he was a Texan. So, okay, a little bit of background here. A little bit of background on me. Okay, when we didn't have a football team in the city of Houston. My team was the Baltimore Ravens. So I was a big Baltimore Ravens guy, you know, like defensive guys. Often, I mean, that was my team, right? Ed Reed was one of my favorite players. So when he came to the Texans, I was like, holy shit, here we go. This is
one of those moments where you could clearly see we didn't share our content before the video started.
No, yeah, no, we definitely did. No, this is, yeah, we're both coming.
We did not discuss what was about to happen.
Which is what's going to make this
I'm fucking blown away that you look, just said, hey, Ed Reed. And you, okay, I need more. But, I need okay. more understanding.
All right, so, but this is what we talked about, though. What we did talk about before we hit record was the fact that the Houston Texans, first of all, we're a very young franchise, right? I mean, like, we're only 22, 23 years into the mix, 21, 22 years, something. We start, 2002?
We a lost child away, you know, as a franchise. Meaning, you know, you probably got one around that age. I probably got one around that age.
For sure. Yeah, so that's my point, though.
Long lost kid.
Franchise. And in the realm of that time, we really haven't had, like, a lot of success. And the success that we did have was with a very small core of guys from a skill standpoint that were just like absolutely skilled, right? So in terms of me having like just like we don't have like a Colts fan, like our boy John, right? Who had Manning, right? Who was like just a long-standing guy that the team had a lot of success with that. Let's just face it, if you're a Colts fan, you're a Peyton Manning fan, right? The same thing goes for the New England Patriots, right? If you're a New England Patriots fan, you're a Tom Brady fan because you had so much success with that guy. And then subsequently, like a small group of guys that are like, that he just, you know, became such a big part of, right?
I understand.
So I'm defending my Ed Reed.
Oh, you gotta defend this.
So I'm not, Ed Reed is not one of my favorite players. For the player that he was when he came to the Texans, Ed Reed was one of my favorite players. For a player that he was when he was over in Baltimore, who was an absolute ball hawk. I mean, you couldn't throw Ed Reed's direction. Let's face it, right? During that time, you just couldn't throw his direction. He was one of the greatest. He was one of the greatest corners. You just can't argue that, okay? However, the reason why he came to the Texans is hilarious because at the time, Papa McNair was like, "That guy keeps beating us. I want to hand him a bag full of money to come over to the Houston, Texas.
I like your impression.
And do absolutely nothing, right?
Yeah.
So, story has it that when he came over here, and I have this confirmed by two friends of mine, one of them who was a strip club owner and the other one who was a strip club DJ, who would tell me that he would literally pull up to strip clubs with a garbage bag full of money because they paid him so much money to come over and he was completely washed at the end of his career. And all he did in the city of Houston was probably pay for more tuition than anybody in the world, probably more than James Harden. You guys think James Harden was a strip club guy? Nah, Ed Reed ran downtown Houston when he was here.
Look,
and he's one of my favorite players. He's one of my favorite players. And then we had him here as a Texan for a little bit. And he played, but let's face it. He was like, by the time we got him, he was what, year 12? 2, 3, 4.
Oh, clearly.
He was year 11 by the time we got him. So, I mean, he was washed up, man. But he had beat us so bad so many times that Papa McNair was like, I just got to have that guy on my team. And, like, completely fleeced, like, the organization. And he's hilarious. He's like,
I'm letting you go because
he's a Miami guy.
I'm trying to hear this explanation because I want to understand. I want my mind to be changed. Whenever I hear something challenging,
yeah,
I'll allow it.
I'm not even trying to convince you. I'm telling you, it's crazy.
Be convinced. No, I want to be convinced. No. Make me think I'm crazy.
No, you're not crazy. I'm crazy. I'm completely aware of this. Ed Reed is one of my favorite players during the time that I was a massive Baltimore fan. And so when he came over here, that's just what it was.
I'm stressed.
Yeah.
This is me stressed.
one of the reasons why he's on one of my top 10 Texans players because he became a Texans player. And I never thought that was ever going to happen. He didn't contribute at all.
From what I understand,
let's clear that up.
One or two things is happening. You know, obviously, you're still living off that initial hype of hearing that Ed Reed is signing
for sure
to the Texans.
For sure.
Number two, I could understand if you were coming from the perspective of a stripper that benefited from all
that he got paid.
Because if you told me that you worked at the Rhino Diamond or whatever, or Heartbreakers or whatever, you were like,
hey, Panasties.
I got a bag from when Ed Reed was initially signed with the city. And I could be like, you know what? I completely understand that perspective.
What's crazy is that the year that he was here was the one year that we didn't make to the conference, like that we didn't win the conference. I think it was like 12 or 13 when we got him. We had a whole team.
He robbed us.
100%.
There's no mistake. Like, he's a top 10 villain of
100%.
The
100%. I do not disagree with you at all.
He was a top 10 villain list.
He was one of my favorite players, and then he became a Texan, and then he robbed the idiots that were the front office blind and just, you know, completely exposed the fact that our front office was run by a bunch of hillbillies with money, you know?
This is not a name that I was expecting to hear.
I'm pretty sure. I told you I had some oddballs.
You weren't fucking lying.
I was not.
You came out swinging with the dismay.
Oh, buddy, this is just the first one here.
Oh, man. Oh, my God, bro. I don't
even think you want to hear the last, number nine. Number nine is going to get hilarious.
I'll
let you go ahead with number 10.
I'm appalled.
Oh, man.
Oh my God! All right, so
I kicked this off proper. I love it.
You did, bro. In the spirit of not making this video three hours long, I'm talking shit
about my man Ed Reed. Let me make sure that the year. Yeah, so we got him in 2013, and that's the year that we didn't go because we won the division in 12. Did we win it in 13? No, 12, we didn't win it again until 15.
Bro, 12 was our best record.
Right, I think
12 was our best record ever.
Ever, yeah,
we
yeah,
went
yeah.
12-4.
Right,
if I'm not mistaken. Right. So look, let me segue into my number 10 with that being said. All right. You're talking about a 12-4 record in 2012. 2011, in my opinion, Omar, was our year. This was our year.
2011. Yeah.
2011 was our year. We didn't have the best record. We went 10-6 that year, but it's not always about how you start. Is about how you finish.
This is
the known thing when it comes to sport, especially football in particular. We finished the year on a 7-game winning streak, but Matt Schaub was playing phenomenal. And look, I thought my number 10 pick was going to be controversial. You said fucking Ed Reed. Like, you took all the thunder out of mine. I tried my hardest to keep Matt Schaub off of my top 10 list. But it's impossible. It's impossible, Omar. He was, still on paper at this current moment. I know we got CJ. Deshaun balled out, when he was here for some years. And obviously we know what happened with him.
Right.
But Matt Schaub is our franchise's best quarterback right now up to this point, on paper.
Yes.
He did his thing. So 2011, man. Balling out. Like I say, we're on our way. We're going into the playoffs. We're riding a winning streak. Gets hurt. I think we're playing Tampa Bay. Freaking Albert Haynesworth. Talking about a nigga robbing a franchise. Talking about a nigga robbing a franchise. Just like Ed Reed. He went in there, got the bag and said, deuces, man. I'm good. I'm a ride this. I got this money, this generational wealth. Now I'm good. Just a simple quarterback sneak Matt Schaub did. Albert Haynesworth crushed his leg, man. And that made him out for the season. And it sucks because I bring up Albert Haynesworth because obviously he was the one that initiated the injury. But sometimes in sports, bro, you injure someone. And you have the ability to be like, damn, man, my bad. I didn't mean to do that. Didn't mean to screw you up. No, he loved it.
Yeah.
He loved that he did that.
He reveled in there.
He reveled, bro. He sucks. He's like a Richie Incognito, like these terrible guys, man.
Incognito. Well, you bringing up some names.
And Namakin Sue, you know, like these guys.
Dirty, man. I never liked Sue.
He's the Draymond Green of football. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, and now it sucked. And then we went into the playoffs thinking that we were going, we had Matt Leinart and TJ Yates on the bench. And we were like, okay, we got Leinart. You know, this is the USC prodigy. This is the guy who's won national championships. He played, in my opinion, the greatest college football game of all time opposite Vince Young and Texas Longhorns in that game. And you like, Leinart got us. We're good. His very next game, he gets hurt. Collarbone injury. He's out. So we got our third string. TJ Yates comes in. TJ Yates. And I'm realizing now in my old age, I was delusional.
Right. Like, of course. When you're in the moment,
when you're in the moment. Yeah.
You can't help it.
You can't. You can't, man. And it, you know, we actually ended the season on the winning streak. He won us the games that we needed to win. We beat the Cincinnati Bengals, I believe, in the very last game of the season. And we had them in back-to-back games in the first, our franchise's very first playoff game. And TJ held his own, man. He did his thing. He got us a win. You know, we felt good. And we got to Baltimore versus your boy who you love, that you love stealing money from my franchise, and you know, we faced reality, and
actually, I think I still have that. Our first, no, when was that? 2012, first playoff game ever. 2012.
It was the 2011 season, but it probably would have been played in 2012 in like January. So
yeah, January 7th. So that's the placard that I have up here. January 7th, 2012, ended up beating the Bengals. 31-10.
Yes, sir. Yeah, man.
I got a really nice plaque up there with that. Commemorating that.
If Matt Schaub would have been there for that game against the Ravens, we would have won. Right, we would have beat him. We had
Flacco at the time.
Who was that? Yeah. We would have to face the Patriots in the championship.
Right.
But like I say, man, it just felt good. We just felt good. But anyway. I say all that to say, Matt Schaub is my number 10 all-time greatest Texans player.
So just to tie in for Ed Reed again, realize that after that devastating season is when Papa McNair was like, I got to get Ed Reed. Ed Reed's what we need.
It was after the 12-4 season.
Right, right.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, that's it. We get Ed Reed, it's a wrap.
We're
going to the championships, baby, and then we didn't even make it to the playoffs that year.
No, dude, correct me if I'm wrong. I think we had like our worst season.
Yeah,
we went like 2-14 or something.
Yeah, Matt Schaub was never the same after that. And we got off to a really bad start at the beginning of that season. What was that? That was 2013, if I'm not mistaken.
I think we won our first two games. And went over after that, bro. It was a train wreck.
Yeah, I remember.
And it was so unexpected because, I mean, we just come off a phenomenal season. Texans were balling out. We still had pretty much all our guys. It was like, what the hell?
You're absolutely correct. Won our first two games against San Diego and Tennessee and then just took a string of L's after that. We didn't win a single game after that.
That's crazy.
And that had a lot to do with the fact that Ed Reed was in the strip clubs every night. I mean, just...
I wouldn't doubt it.
Absolutely, absolutely crazy. Foster was putting up numbers at the time. Anyway, we'll get to some of those guys here in a second.
Yeah, man.
So that's your number 10.
That's my number 10, man. And like I say, I wanted to leave him off the list, but it's just impossible.
You can't. No, you can't.
I realized my folly, right? Like, I'm thinking about his fall off.
Yeah, right.
What did he do? He threw like consecutive pick sixes, like six games in a row or something.
Crazy. Yeah, he was on that streak. I remember that.
He became Dak Prescott all of a sudden, bro. It's like,
Now, granted, the two games that we won weren't close, right? But
no,
I mean, Schaub in the first game threw for 346 yards. threw for 346 yards and then never threw for more than 300 yards ever again.
Yeah, it was crazy, bro. Like a 346 yard game was just so common for Schaub, you know.
Right,
man. It was exactly. That was the "in Schaub we trust" era, man. You know, he was riding high. Like, he was never like a household name, like, you know, at the time, like a Michael Vick or like a Donovan McNabb or somebody like that. He wasn't flashy. He wasn't the sexiest name in quarterback play, but he was just so consistent, man. He was so consistent.
He was solid.
He was solid.
And they didn't put any real pieces around him. I mean, he had Andre.
Yeah.
But Andre wasn't going to do it all himself.
He couldn't.
Right? Like, we had one runner, one real solid.
Kevin Walter, I think, a white receiver.
Yes, Kevin Walter. That's right.
And Jacoby Jones. Jacoby Jones. Owen Daniels was the tight end.
Owen Daniels, that's right. Yeah.
We had a squad.
Bunch of wide guard, but, you know. That may be half the problem. We had no speed.
I wasn't going to say it.
White guys are running a 4.8.
They were. The 4.8. I wasn't gonna say it on this Juneteenth. I'm good.
Oh, yeah, happy Juneteenth.
Thank you. It took you too long to wish me that shit. And then you gonna say some Ed Reed shit. You really got your blood boiling up.
All right, so look, let me give you my number nine. Let me make it up a little bit.
We got it. Yeah, we got it. Yeah.
My number nine is once again on the defensive side of the ball. We're all very well aware of the legend that is J.J. Watt, right? Everybody's clear on who J.J. Watt is. However, J.J. Watt's rookie year, he wasn't that explosive. You know who was explosive? Who's my man, Connor Barwin. Connor Barwin, my number nine player, was, I think, the year, as a matter of fact, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that 2011 season, I think Connor was like 13 or 14 sacks for that season. I mean, the kid was just absolutely killing everybody. Here we go. Total tackles, almost 50 total tackles for the season. 38 of them solo tackles. Assists on 13 and 11 and a half sacks with fumble recoveries, forced fumbles, and then he actually scored a touchdown that year. I mean, Connor Barwin, before J.J. Watt came, 2011. This was on that 2011 one.
Okay.
But even still, what was funny is that when J.J. Watt came in, his production went steeply declined because the following year he only had 3 sacks because J.J. was – that was by the time J.J. was pumping up and he was J.J., you know?
Yeah.
But, yeah, he's my number nine, man. I really liked him. He was really an eccentric kind of guy. He was like always at Coachella and, you know, he was a big music guy. Yeah. Before Kendrick Lamar was Kendrick Lamar, he was like, you know, always talking about tweeting about Kendrick Lamar being the greatest lyricist and ever, you know. He was just kind of like this really funky, eccentric guy. And then, like, he always had these weird haircuts and stuff like that, but he was an absolute beast. And he had a bit of a personality, which I thought was cool, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. And then he just, that year was absolutely a phenomenal year. And then I think a couple years after that, we had him for 9, 11, and 12, and then we traded him to Philly. And then in Philly, he did have a good career in Philly. Yeah, he had a great career in Philly, won a couple championships. So, yeah, it was good, man. I he was one of my favorites, again, on that side of the ball. And then for a couple of years there, when it was him alongside J.J., I mean, where were you going to run to? You weren't going to run into Connor Barwin. And you kind of had to pick your poison, right? It's like you had two absolute monsters that were there. And then, you know, right around that time, I think Cushing was still around, right? So,
Of course.
So, I mean, you just had like these crazy ass dudes.
Antonio Smith was on that line too.
The ninja. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. The ninja, Antonio Smith. Yeah. So,
yeah.
This was
a great era, man. So,
great.
Obviously, I'm not mad at this pick at all. I'm a little surprised. You know, when you talk about top 10 Texans players of all time, you're kind of not expecting to hear Connor Barwin, but these were the lunch pail guys. And I appreciate what you're saying. Like, you gotta have those guys in order to it's the straw that stirs the drink, right? Like, this was the Bulls on Parade era.
Yes,
you know, at that time.
The linemen, these guys were the Letterman jackets.
Yeah. They were getting after it.
Yeah.
They were getting after it, man. And like you say, this is right before JJ had his ascension. And right. I mean, you never know. You know, it being around those guys, I mean, could have helped form
what
JJ was able to be. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah, 100%. And I think it's, you know, it's the whole steel sharpens steel thing, right? I mean, like, obviously, yeah. JJ, you look at JJ when we drafted him, and you look at JJ even now. I mean, yeah. Not the same guy. Right.
No.
Like, not the same. I mean, like,
not at all.
So much so that there was some talks about old JJ, you know, on those Mexican supplements. You know what I'm saying? I mean, because you know what I'm saying? Because the dude was.
I never heard him refer to as Mexican supplements.
you never heard about that. I don't know. You're a boxing guy. Well, you're not a very big boxing guy. But Canelo, when he got popped for PEDs, he said that he was eating meat that was that came from cows that had supplements.
Oh, gotcha.
And so they say that's what happened or something.
You got into the Mexican cows.
Yeah. You got into the Mexican cows and the Mexican supplements.
Yeah.
So that's like the running joke. But yeah, I mean, and so before JJ came along, and to be honest with you, man, like
JJ had that big back then, bro.
But JJ is kind of what I mean. Let's be honest here. JJ is who kind of put the Texans on the map, right? I mean, with all due respect to you know, to Andre Johnson, who's our now Hall of Fame, a Hall of Famer. There really wasn't like big buzz. I mean, you're not wrong. Andre carried his own buzz. You know, he was coming from Miami. He carried his own buzz, and he completely lived up to all of the hype that he got. Right,
but I get what you're saying. Like, as far as like
marketability, and the endearment, because
Andre is a soft-spoken guy, or not soft-spoken, exactly. But he's just not a man of many words, and he carried himself in a way in the locker room and on the field. Obviously, that's where it mattered. But
he was very
marketability
stoic.
Came with JJ.
Yeah. Andre Johnson was an absolute phenom on the field, but he was very stoic in like as his personality. He wasn't outgoing, he wasn't flashy, he wasn't anything that you could get behind from a marketing standpoint.
Yeah.
JJ, however, was he wasn't that either, but he was like the darling, right? He was like he was just this clean-cut darling kid from, you know, where's he, Wisconsin. Nebraska?
Yeah. I used to be a piece of delivery boy. I walked on to the football team. He was kind of a cornball, bro, if we're being honest.
Right. So a lot of the guys that I have, you know, like a little bit of love for pre that era are not going to be like very big names in the grand scheme of things, right? But if you were around before JJ, like pre-JJ, then some of these guys you're really going to understand, as you do, the role that they played, right? And so that's why Connor's my guy.
So in that same vein, my number nine, we touched on this a little bit in one of our previous episodes, man. The importance of having a good center is so important to a team and its success.
I think you're about to pick my guy.
We had a great center. And if I am picking one of your guys, because as we talked about, guys, you know, obviously we're going to bounce off of each other. So a lot of these, especially once we get towards the top five,
right.
They're definitely going to overlap, right? So, you could throw in like any stats that you have about this guy. Chris Myers. Phenomenal center for us, man. One of those guys that, you know, like we talked about, doesn't have the huge marketability. You know, it's besides Jason Kelce, what center are you really talking about? You know what I'm saying? But Chris Myers was one of those guys that did the same things like a Jason Kelce did, you know, not the whole sneak deal and all that kind of stuff, but just, you know, as far as helping, you know, point out
the world,
things like that. Yeah, man.
Saturday. Just
a dependable guy. And someone that we missed, you know, honestly. You know, we haven't had a great center, you know, anywhere near Chris Myers, you know, since he's left. But yeah, you know, I'm not gonna hang on him too long, man. But you know, if you got anything to add to that, because like I say, at some point I'm sure he'll come up on your list. But that is my number nine for sure.
So you have him at nine. I had him at eight.
Okay, so perfect.
That's my guy at eight.
Perfect.
Again, just and we talked about this, right? You asked me a couple of episodes ago, what did I feel was one of the most important positions besides a quarterback? And my answer was the center. And I could not leave out, I could not have left out Myers, you know, from that conversation. So yeah, he's my number eight. Again, he almost was a cornerstone of that entire offense, right? As you know, as you're coming up to the ball and he's calling out, you know, he was really big on calling out, you know, like, hey, you got some defensive, you got some coverage over there. And a lot of that, if you go back and watch some of those, he caused a lot of havoc just by calling things out and then ultimately them having to audible some stuff. And, you know, just if you got a good center, it can make things flow so much better for you.
Absolutely.
As an offense. So that's my eight. So we'll bounce it back to you for number eight.
All right, man. Bro, some of these names that I had on my list, I thought were going to be surprising to folks. But your number 10 pick of Ed Reed, nothing is going to be a shocker at this point.
No, I don't think so.
No.
I think my next one's going to kind of shock you a little bit.
I thought I was going to throw you off or cause a little controversy with my number 8, but like I say, absolutely nothing is shocking at this point. My number 8, bro, and this guy is an absolute Hall of Famer. Okay. I think we got 3 surefire Hall of Famers. Obviously, we got Andre going into the Hall of Fame this year. Well deserved. No question. JJ, obviously, when he's up, if he doesn't come back and play this year, his first year eligibility 3 years from now, he's going to be in there. First ballot.
For sure. Yeah.
Our next Hall of Famer, man, played for the Texans in the punter position is Shane Leckler.
Oh, no, you didn't.
Shane Leckler, absolutely my number 8. Hall of Famer.
Wait a second. Wait a second.
Don't.
A punter?
No. Nigga, no. You don't deserve to give me any question or come.
Wait a minute.
Not after that Ed Reed shit. You don't get to question me at all. Okay? I could put a fucking water boy on this list at this point. You can't say shit.
A punter.
A Hall of Fame punter.
I'm with you.
Hall of Fame punter.
I mean, okay.
He's going in, man. He's going in. Phenomenal punter, man.
How many punters are in the Hall of Fame?
That's a great question.
Let's take a look.
I'm curious on that. Yeah.
There are 4. Oh, sorry. 1. There's 4 place kickers and 1 punter in the Hall of Fame. I think what I'm more shocked about is your claim that he will be our next Hall of Famer. That's the one that's a little shocking. I mean,
he's been retired, I think, the right amount of time. If not, he's coming up on it. Not to say that he's going to be a first ballot or anything like that, but
he will be a never ballot.
Okay. So this is where we disagree, man. There's some controversy.
He will be a never ballot. I'm trying to go back and I remember him. He was a big guy. He was a big, sturdy guy.
And could kick the ball phenomenally. You gotta have a good punter, man. I mean, you know, having a good punter, it changes the game. It flips the field. You know what I'm saying?
You might be onto something.
I know I'm on something. He deserves to be on my list. He deserves to be on 6-time a lot of people's
list. 6-time first team All Pro. 7-time Super Bowl. Jesus. Who was he a Super Bowl? Who?
He got a resume. Obviously not with the Texans, but he got on him.
No, he's okay. So look, 6-time first team All Pro, 7-time Super Bowl champion, 4-time NFL punting yard leader, Golden Toe Award. 2000s all-team decade, all-decade team. 2010 all-decade team. 100th anniversary all-decade, all-team. 2-time first All-American, 7-time All-American, 3-time first Big 12. Okay. I mean, yeah, he's good. Look, I mean.
He got the resume, dog.
He does got the resume. He's got the highest career average ever for a punter, 46 yards per punt. Yeah. I remember he used to pin him.
Yeah.
He used to pin him consistently.
I'm telling you.
into the back of the end zone. I mean, like, literally pin him right up there. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I mean, hey, consider me convinced. I mean, I wouldn't have thrown him in at 8, but all right.
Yeah, he deserved to be there, man.
I dig that.
He deserved to be there. So what's up? But what you got? What you got? Who you got? Let's hop on to number 7.
Number 7. So here's your number 7. Number 7, you ready? Once again, big personality, big guy that came over from the New England Patriots that we threw a ton of money at for no apparent reason other than the fact that we had a front office that didn't know what the fuck they were doing. And I loved them. I loved them for being on the team. Big Vince, Big Vince Wilforks.
You know, I'm not as mad at this one as I am with the
NBA. Yeah, you can't be.
He came over.
Big body nose tackle. Right. Yeah. He was Big Papa Pump he was out there.
I'm gonna tell you, the only thing that I am mad at with Big Vince is that stupid ass play that they pulled out in the playoffs where he lined up, I think, his fullback. JJ lined up his tailback. Yeah, yeah. And they thought this shit was about to work. Oh, my bro. It was.
But think about it, though. Big body. They just kind of figured Refrigerator Perry this thing in there. And it's like, nah. Come on.
Nah, that shit was terrible.
Because he was just big. He was just big. Yeah. I mean, he was big and strong, but he was just big.
He was big. He was athletic, though.
He was. Bigness. He was a big dude.
And obviously, not to take anything away, phenomenal career by this guy. One of the 100%. Top Patriots players of all time. One of the top nose tackles of all time. I mean, just 100% phenomenal player.
Yeah.
With him,
probably has a better chance of making it to the Hall of Fame than Shane Leckler. Let's just go with that. But you know,
well, yeah, I'll give you that.
But multiple time. I mean, let me see.
Hey, don't be hating on my Shane Leckler pick.
Like, I'm not hating on your Shane Leckler pick.
Not after the Ed Reed shit.
Two times Super Bowl.
Vince didn't come over and rob us the way that Ed Reed did,
no,
for sure.
No, no,
so
no.
I'm not mad at that pick. All right. But it didn't produce, it didn't will the results that we were hoping for. But
no. It didn't, unfortunately. I mean, we're looking at let's see, how did we do that? That's because we only got him for like 2 years. I think we ended up getting him 15-16, both playoff season appearances. Not too bad. I mean, big heavy guy down in the trenches, did a lot of work.
Yeah.
Came with a just stellar resume from New England.
Absolutely.
This is yet another indicator, right, of the shiny penny syndrome. Right. Like where like he saw something shiny, paid a lot of money for it. And, you know, and we're getting these guys at the tail end of their career.
Exactly.
They're absolute like personalities more than anything. Right.
Yeah.
And we ended up paying a bunch of these guys for what they did, not what they could do, which is like some of the dumbest shit that you can do whenever you're trying to put a roster together. Right. Or a roster that's going to yield you any type of results the following year. Right. It's like 100%. To pay a guy for what he did last year. It's like, come on, you know,
100%.
But 100%. Anyway,
yeah,
that was my seven.
The Texans and the Rockets are notorious for that, bro. They love bringing in guys at the tail end of their career.
Yeah.
Based off of what they've done in the past, hoping that they could like recreate a little bit of that magic to help them get over the hump. And it never works out like that, man. So this is one of those picks. Hopefully we got to cut that shit out. We got to stop doing that, man.
I think you and I have talked about this, right? Like I think one of the biggest things that we can attribute our turnaround to is our front office. Is this newly formed front office that's actually making good moves,
yeah,
good sustainable moves that are going to put us in a position to be I don't want to go ahead and call us a dynasty, but we have this young core of guys that can potentially bear fruit for the next 3 or 4 seasons, right? We're not living paycheck to paycheck, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So yeah, anyway, Big Vince, that's my number seven.
Big Vince, that's your number seven, man. So quickly, let's recap real quick, man, where we at. So, yeah. So your number 10, you started this thing out with a bang. You picked Ed fucking Reed.
Ed Reed, baby.
Robbed this organization blind, came in, it took us for a while. I'm still dumbfounded, man. I came in, my top, my number 10 was messed up. You came at your number 9, Connor Barwin, which, like I say, that's not a... I'm not mad at it. My number 9 was Chris Myers. We were on the same wavelength with that one because your number 8
was Chris Myers. That's right.
Was Chris Myers. And yep. My number 8 was Shane Lechler. Your number 7,
Big Vince.
You came in with Big Vince. All right. So correct. We go.
Now we get to the nitty gritty where I think a lot of our, well, with the exception of my number 6, but you got number 7. So what's your number 7?
Yeah. My number 7, man. You'll like this. You're talking about the defensive side of the ball. Jonathan Joseph. Gotta have him at number 7, man.
Yes.
You know, obviously we were living in an era around this time. You know, everybody was obsessed with having a shutdown corner.
Right.
You know, you wanted to try to shut down one half of the field. You had, obviously, everybody knows Revis Island. Darrell Revis was doing this thing with the Jets. Everybody was obsessed with Nnamdi Asomugha.
I remember.
Right, he was supposed to be the second coming, right? Like, he was doing his thing, I believe, with the Raiders. Then he got traded to Philly, and they thought they had a dream team. This is right. When Michael Vick was doing his thing. This is when, it didn't work out. But anyway, everybody was obsessed with having a shutdown corner. But we had probably the most solid, probably the most underrated corner, I believe, man, in J.J. I don't know if he ever missed a game, bro. He was so solid, man. He was just so great. He just did his thing. He was lunch pail guy. Wasn't the flashiest of guys, like right. You say. I mean, we still dealing with a Texans team who, we just weren't the sexiest of teams. Right. Even though around this time we were winning games, we were making traction. This was in that 2011-2012 season when we were, you know, having good records. And some people had us on their radar saying that maybe we can make some noise. J.J. was out there shutting down receivers, man. Yep. And throughout the years, man, he had some good guys opposite of him. He had Kareem Jackson. I'm blanking on the dude that ended up going to
Jacoby Jones,
Jacksonville.
Who was it?
I'm saying playing opposite.
Oh, okay, I gotcha.
Man, I can't remember his name. He was a good one though, but. We had some good defenses back in those days, man. The Bulls on parade, but J.J. Right. was our guy, man. He was a good corner for us, man. So
yeah, while the main three that we talked about, right, which is Barwin, Antonio Smith, J.J. Cushing, while those guys were crashing down on the line, making it hard for, you know, defenses to really sit in the pocket and try to figure out what was going, you still had to worry about J.J. on the other side of the ball, right?
Yes,
so absolutely. not only do you have these animals coming at you, right, like that are just absolute beasts, now you got to worry about only having half of the field available to you to throw to,
yeah,
right, because 100%. You didn't want to throw in his direct. I mean, like, that was just such a great defensive team.
It
that
was,
2011 man. 2012 that 2011 defensive team was top notch, man. I mean, yeah, that's a good one. I didn't have J.J. on my list at all, which is interesting.
But you had Ed Reed.
Oh, for sure. For sure. Don't disrespect Ed Reed, bro. You know what? I'm gonna go get me an Ed Reed jersey. I'm gonna find a Texans Ed Reed jersey.
They gonna shoot you upon sight on just asking for that shit. And be like, bro.
You know what? Do not tempt me, sir.
Nah, that's awful. That's crazy, man.
Texans.
Now, don't even look that up, bro. I hope they charge you $5,000 for that shit.
And
you know who's going to be selling it? It's Ed Reed.
It's going to be cheap. Hey, it's going to be cheap. Bruh. I just found one for $10. Oh, yes, baby. Let's go. Big number 20. Ed Reed. Hell oh, yeah, bro. Look at that.
That's funny.
Oh, that's hilarious. That's hilarious. All right. That was your number 7.
Yes, sir.
Number 7. My number 6, oddly enough, not a defensive guy, but for all of the same sentiments that you have given for this player being on your top 10.
Okay.
He's on my top 10 because I feel like you can't forget the fact that there was a time where he was our guy.
Okay.
He led us, right? He led us to, at the time, was the best record that we ever had and still is, still holding. I got Schaub at number 6.
Okay. Okay.
And just
not mad. Because,
yeah. Just because I feel like ever since, like, he was the peak of our existence as a franchise, right? Yeah. Like he is the one that led us to that peak of us as a franchise. And then once again, if you look at the history books, it was a steep drop off after that. Like when everything was clicking on like when we were running on all cylinders with Schaub at the helm, we were a pretty fucking good team.
Great
and
team.
We made it pretty far. And had he held up and had he not gotten injured, we probably would have been deep into the playoffs that year.
Yeah.
Right. Like, I mean, that was, like you said, other than this year, that was the only other year where people were going, whoa, okay. These guys are actually coming. They're hitting us hard.
In Schaub we trust, man.
You know, in Schaub we trust. That's right.
That's the time. Right. Now, bro, was there a more scarier moment in football? Obviously for opposing teams, because for us, we loved it. But can you imagine a scarier time for defensive coordinators and fans of the opposing team than when Schaub stuck that hand out to fake like he was going to give it to Arian and it flipped out on that bootleg? Oh, my. Because you just knew. You felt a rush in your body. You're like, he about to bomb this shit down to Andre's going to be Andre, wide you know Andre's open. Like,
exactly. because they had to respect Arian at the time.
You had to. And
you had to respect Arian. You had to respect Foster.
Talk about the – I mean, it's what we talk about now, right, and having a great scheme. Bobby Slowick over here doing this thing.
Right.
Who was scheming those plays up back then? Right. That was Gary Kubiak. This was that Kyle Shanahan tree. Guess what? You know, the Mike Shanahan tree back then, right? Yeah. And now it's the Kyle Shanahan tree that everybody is mimicking. But it was the same thing. You had to respect that zone running game, that zone running system, man. And you knew you were going to get torched. You knew you were about to get gashed if you didn't get over there and respect that run, because Arian was a genius with the run. So everybody had to collapse on it. But when Schaub booted out, oh man, that play action game was just downright incredible, man. So, hey, I am 100% not mad at it, man. That's your number 6 pick. That's
my number 6. Yeah, we're down to the top 5
of Matt Schaub. So, yeah, I will ask you right now, Omar. We can do this or we cannot, man. We can totally keep on running with it, bro. You know, anybody out there watching with us, man. If you like what you're seeing right now at this point of our video, guys, please hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. This is what we do. We're going to give you our content. Obviously, the mainstay of our channel is obviously talking about more up-to-date and relevant Texas current news about the guys that we have on the roster right now and the upcoming Super Bowl run, our bull run season, how we going to win the Super Bowl this year, man. But as old niggas, we like to do this shit too. We like to reminisce on the good times.
That's right.
You know, so
and the bad, apparently, because I got Ed Reed at number 10. So
you might as well have had Bill O'Brien as your number 10. That's just as
listen.
Bad. Damn, bro. I'm at a loss for words. It was a top 10 villain list.
But that's the thing though. It's like the top 10. The top 10 players are the top 10 Houston Texans of all time, right? Because
I got to respect it.
You know what I mean? It's like, okay, Ed Reed wasn't a good player, but for me, Ed Reed was one of my favorites. So when we got him as a Texan, I was like, what? What? It's like when we got Scottie Pippen as a Rocket.
See, I told you, bro. That's what we do as these Texans.
Well, we got Tracy McGrady as a Rocket. Teams.
He was still in his prime, though.
He was.
He was still in his prime.
But still, I mean,
Scottie Pippen's, the Barkley's of the world. who else did we? I mean, you could say Chris Paul.
Chris Paul, yeah.
Westbrook too. I mean, we got Westbrook, these guys. We got him
for a little bit, yeah. But yeah. Westbrook went on to do well afterwards. I mean, yeah, it's just, you know, it's like, hey, tail end of your career, right? We're not going to pay you a whole lot, but you're going to be in Texas, so no state income tax.
Come on down.
Come on down. You know, it's like that. You ever seen the movie Moneyball?
Yes, sir.
Where he was like, I'm trying to squeeze the last little bit of baseball you got in. And when he told David Justice that, I'm trying to squeeze the last little baseball you got in, and you're trying to stay in the show. That was such a great line, man.
Yeah, and a great movie. A great movie. I'll give you that. Great movie.
So you're thinking saving the top five for another episode?
I was gonna say, yeah. If you want to do, man, if we cut it off now. We stop here now, and then we do a part two. We come back with a part two later on.
I love it.
We give you our top five, man. If you're down with it, I'm down with it.
I'm down. I like that. I like that idea. It gives me some time because I have my top five, and I know why they're my top five.
Yeah.
But it'll give me a little bit of more opportunity to talk a little bit more through them, because there's, like, especially one of my guys, there's some really standout moments that were, you know, that were the reason why I became so enamored with them. So it was good.
Cool, man. So yeah, that's how we do, bro. We do this in real time. We ain't got a bunch of overproduction going on, man. We chop it up with y'all just like we chop it up with ourselves. So you know, we gonna leave it here. This is our part one. We go give y'all part two later on. This has been fun, though. I wasn't expecting the air read of it all, bro. I'm gonna be honest with you.
You are shocked.
That threw me.
My boy is shook.
Yeah. Shook it.
I told you, dog. I was gonna have some oddball ones in there.
I thought my oddball was gonna be Matt Schaub and Shane Leckler. I was like,
well, man. Shane Leckler for sure was an oddball, because I don't know how he made it into your top 10. But again, I picked Ed Reed, so I have no room to talk. But. That's good stuff, man. Thank you guys for watching. We appreciate y'all. We love y'all. We'll catch y'all on the next episode. We got more stuff coming out this week.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, newsworthy. It's been kind of funky the last few days. Not really a whole lot going on, but that's just the league in general.
It's June, you know? Man. You know, I don't think official training camp starts until mid-July, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. This is what it's supposed to be right now, man. Everybody's still harping on it's CJ talking too much, but bro, when you can walk the walk, you talk the talk, man. So I ain't mad at that. It ain't too much going on in current Texans news, man. But like Omar said, man, if you like what we got going on and you want to see part two, you want to see what our top five is gonna end up being,
Stay locked in,
hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, man, and we will see y'all on the next one.
Love y'all.
Peace.
Bum, bum, bum.